whole state of California, there's three facilities, all right, that you guys are required to drive through. So Gilroy northbound, okay, we have a southbound side, so only the northbound side, okay. Cordelia eastbound, and then Mountain Pass, which is on the Vegas and California border. Yes, sir.
With passengers?
Yes.
Okay.
So the only bus that is exempt from not pulling in our facility is a loaded school bus. That's it. Everything else, if you're, even if it's a SPAD coach, you're required if you're loaded. If you have children on board, it's a SPAD coach, you're still required to drive there. Okay. Here's the thing though, how we choose our buses to inspect is simple. If you're laden and you're gonna keep going through, we're not gonna inspect your bus, okay? If you're empty and you have no decal or an expired decal, and I'll explain those in a minute, then at that point you are subject to inspection. Okay, so for example, if you guys are laden and you have two, three people in your bus, and we get a call from dispatch, say, hey, this bus is all over the road, they're driving erratic, whatever the case might be, speeding up, slowing down. At that point, Officer Nichols will go out and make an assessment, see what's going on. Maybe you guys are fatigued. There could be something else going on. Even if with those people in the bus, we will inspect the bus, but we just need to make the determination on what we're gonna do. Up to what, 75 passengers? Is that a 75 passenger out there? The double decker?
67?
67, okay. So we gotta make the determination of what we're gonna do with 67 people, right? You guys are gonna have to make arrangements. If there's something wrong with the bus, if it's placed out of service, the driver's having issues, you guys will have to make arrangements to come pick up those passengers or make arrangements to send another driver down to drive the bus away, okay? That is the only time we're gonna inspect a loaded bus, for example. And then the other one will be is if we see something wrong with your bus. So for example, if you're going through our facility and it's evening or it's inclement weather, it's rain, fog or whatever the case might be, and your taillights are not working, you have lighting that's out, that is going to be the other reason why a loaded bus would be inspected. Okay, so those are the only two reasons that we're going to be looking at a loaded bus, period. If you're loaded and you come through and you have all green lights, you guys just keep on going through. Okay. Our goal is not to stop for you to get your destination. It's not to stop compensation. We want you guys to make it to destination on time. I know a lot of the companies are fined heavily if they're late, 5 minutes late, they get fined. I'm not sure how it works, but we want you to get there on time. We want you to get in, you know, get to your destination. We want you to be en route. If you're empty and be en route to pick somebody up, we want you to get there on time as well. All right, Officer Nichols, you have anything?
Where do you want to go?
I was talking about loaded and empty buses, and the only buses exempt were school buses.
Yes.
At this point. So
the only thing is, the biggest thing is you don't want to bypass the scales. It doesn't take that long to go through us. As you can tell, you can watch a truck enter the scales, they drive right through, and if we don't stop them, they keep on going, so it takes a minute or two to go through. The biggest issue is if you bypass the scales, it can be prosecuted as a misdemeanor, okay, which can be up to $1,000 fine, 6 months in jail. I mean, obviously it won't go that heavy, but it can be over $1,000 fine once you put the assessments in. It's also a point and a half on your record because it's a moving violation, basically a failure to be able to make a regulatory sign.
And that's fine.
And that goes against the driver.
Point and a half?
Yes.
Yeah,
because it's your commercial vehicle.
Yeah, your commercial vehicle. I'm putting something together right now. We're trying to get the information from the court and everything. Right now, I just have the vehicle codes and everything that we can put together. Just to cover you guys, in case they tell you, hey, we're not supposed to stop, and say, well, here's the definition of a bus, anything that, because you guys are getting paid, your company's getting paid to transport the employees. So anything that has 11 people or more, including the driver, is considered a bus. So obviously, if you're driving double-deckers, that's that easily, that's the definition. And so you just want to go through, like I said, bypassing. We have our patrol cars parked right over there. So if somebody bypasses us, we can just hop in the patrol car, go stop, see what's going on. And then if we need to, we can write the issue the citation. And we'll do a quick inspection on the side of the road.
So at this point, our goal is to make the transition easier for you guys, right? Yeah. So this is new for buses. So you're gonna hear me say PVI a lot. That's passenger vehicle inspection, okay? That's what we call it, PVI. So if a PVI vehicle goes by and you're loaded and we're open. Obviously, you're subject to enforcement, but by us reaching out to you guys, is our goal is to educate. So we just want to educate you guys and let you know, hey, you guys are loaded, you still come through, we have specifics on how we can choose a bus. If you don't fall under the inspection category, you guys are just going to keep on going. Okay? Yes, sir.
So when you're driving through, how do you know when you're going to get inspected? Like, there's a light or something?
Okay.
Yeah.
So you just get like a red, or right. You're going
to
go
through? No, I can go through that. Perfect timing.
I don't know.
No, we're good. So as you guys are pulling in, if you want to kind of move forward here, as you guys pulled into the lanes earlier, okay, you guys were required to drive all the way through and then circle around and park in the back, okay? So if you see at the entrance there, that there's three overhead signs. Can you guys see those down there?
Yes.
All right, so they got three overhead signs. Those have either a red X or a green X, okay? If it's a red X, that means that particular lane is closed. So we want you to run through the lane that's open. So in the evening time, we will close the outer two lanes so we can see the vehicles closer to the building, so we can see violations, we can see their decals a lot easier. Right during the daytime, we usually keep all three lanes open, so you can go through all three lanes, okay? As long as you have a green X, you're good to go, all right? So you're pulling through, we have overhead sensors here, which hopefully you guys shouldn't have to worry about. We have traffic lights here, okay? Those are considered traffic lights. We had an officer actually cite somebody for running through a red light, so just pay attention as you're going through the overhead lights, okay? You get a red light, you'll get a green arrow if we want you to circle around. And if you have a green light, you can just keep on going through. Okay,
So green arrow means pull
right
to the side.
So,
okay.
Yeah, so well, we
towards the building.
Oh, okay.
And then there's a signboard at the end that'll tell you where to go.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So, and once we get rid of these trucks, if I turn around now, they're actually going to do it.
Right.
So once they pass, I'll show you what the signboard looks like.
So what we usually do though is we usually try to stop you right in front of our scale head. So that way we give you plenty enough time to understand what's going on with the signage, okay? So we'll stop you out here, we'll give you a red light. We can give you an audible command. Hey, can you drive around the door 2, door 3, door 4, please? Just listen. Those speakers aren't the best, so kind of won't want. Kind of sounds like, or is it Charlie Brown? So if you can understand what we're saying, just follow the signage. And if you look down at the far end there, those big signs, it'll direct you on where you need to go. Okay.
So if you look at the far sign on the right side, one closest to the building, we want you to go someplace, so it'll pop up. Like that says, go to the static scale, or it'll tell you go to bay 1, bay 2, bay 3,
bay 2.
It'll tell you where to go.
So when it comes to buses, the three bays that we're going to inspect them in is 2, 3, and 4, because you guys raise and lift. Okay, so we need pits. We don't have ramps, so we can't inspect them in bay number 1.
Okay.
Usually the ramps are at destination. If you guys go to a casino, they're having a strike force. That's when they're starting to use the ramps and do the inspections there. Here, we're in an in-route facility. Okay, we're not a destination, we're in-route. So those are the three bays that we use for inspections. And that's why Cordelia and Mountain Pass are also chosen, because they also have a lift. Okay. Cordelia is on the eastbound in Fairfield.
Okay.
If you guys go over Maston to come back, to circle back?
I believe we did.
Okay, so if you look on the other side of Maston, on south side of the Maston overcross, there's a sign, a big white and black sign that says all buses must enter except for loaded school buses.
Mm-hmm.
So we have four signs, okay? So we have two right there. We have one on the shoulder and one on the center divide. Further south, we have two more in the same location, shoulder and center divide. Those are the signs that you guys really need to pay attention. So Cordelia has them, we have them, and Mountain Pass has them, okay? If those regulatory signs are there, you're required to go through the facilities. Right now, it's just the three though, okay? So you don't have to worry. In the future, it might be all scales, but right now it's just three facilities that you guys are required to drive through.
Okay? If you're going southbound, you don't have to stop.
Yeah.
Go to that scale.
Right.
What highway is Mountain Pass?
That was last day. I think it's 15?
Is it 15?
It's 15.
It's coming out of Vegas.
It's coming out of Vegas.
Oh, coming out into California.
Yes.
Is that west?
North.
Yes. So it's coming out of Vegas. It's a big facility just like this one is.
Oh,
so,
I think I saw that one.
Right. So again, if you're loaded, you still are required to drive through. If you're empty, you're required to drive through. And then the only time you can bypass our facility is if our, if we're closed during the hours of service. So our hours of service are Monday through Friday, they're 24 hours, okay?
So Monday through Friday.
Yes. There are times we are open on Saturdays, so just be aware.
Surprise.
Yeah, hello, welcome on a Saturday. But there are times we are open on Saturdays, so if we are open on Saturdays, all the signs will be, the signs will say all vehicles come in. And then you just got, you guys come in and pull in the same way as you would throughout the week, okay? So, Officer Nichols, you want to explain the stickers?
So, you'll notice on trucks, like he's got an orange sticker in the lower right-hand corner. So, on a bus, it'll be on the door, basically the eye level. So we're looking for the stickers, so it's all by month. So, and then it's broken down by quarter. So at the beginning of the year in January, we started with a green sticker, and it goes yellow, orange, and white. And we go by the number of tabs that are pulled off of it. So if there are two tabs pulled off, it's January, it's the beginning of the quarter and stuff. So we're looking for stickers that are expired. We're looking for vehicles that don't have stickers, stuff like that. So if you have a current sticker, unless you have some major malfunction with your vehicle, you're just gonna keep going. You don't have to worry about us, okay? So if there's, if you're due for a sticker, then we can pull you in. When you get a sticker, it's good for the rest of that month plus the next 2 months. So if you get a sticker this month, which is November, it's good for the rest of this month, all of December, and all of January. So then you'd be due for inspection in February.
No, we're not responsible. The Republic puts the stickers or whenever they have it inspected.
No, you don't. So those are our stickers. Those are given us by the Commercial Vehicle Safety Alliance. That's how we choose every single inspection for all the vehicles that we inspect, okay? Doesn't matter if it's a truck or a tractor trailer or a tow truck for that matter, or a coach or a stretch limousine. Okay, so we base everything off that decal. Our priority is vehicles, commercial vehicles without a decal. That's number one for us, okay? So it doesn't matter what kind of commercial vehicle it is if it does not have the decal, that's priority. With coaches, if you have no decal and you're empty, that's priority, okay? If you have an expired decal and you're empty, that's next in line. If you have a current decal and you're empty, or I'm sorry, no decal, a current decal and empty, you can just go keep on going through it, okay? If you're loaded though, and you come through and you have no decal, you're not subject to inspection for us, unless we see something wrong like we talked about earlier, okay? If you're loaded, you're not subject, remember that. If you have one person in the bus, one passenger, that's all it takes. That's it. So you guys can keep on going. All right? Anything else?
Do you guys have any questions?
So right now we should all have the white sticker because of...
Right now we're in November.
Yeah.
So it'd be white sticker or even September is still good. So September, October, November, all good.
So the number is the year. So right now we're still in zero. As of January 1, we'll have a 1. Okay. And then it starts by quarters. We recommend that you guys come in if you want to volunteer in the first week of whatever month the decal starts in, okay? That way you get the full 90 days out of that decal. If you come in towards the end of the month, on that first month, excuse me, say if you come in the end of the month on January, it's the last week, you're only gonna get 2 months out of that decal. All right, so if you guys want to continuously volunteer, bring your coaches in, keep them current, that way you're not pulling in on a regular basis. Coming in the first week, you get the 90 days out of the decal. Okay, so it's the month of and 2 months after. That's the way we see it. Okay? Any questions in regards to how we choose our vehicles? Any questions on the sticker? The why me? The pamphlet I gave you, that breaks down the decals. So you guys can know. I'll get you one. Yeah. This is it. This is all commercial vehicles. This mainly applies to tractor trailers and other commercial vehicles, but you guys can use this as well for the stickers, okay?
Okay.
The how-to, the pamphlet right next to that, is basically explains how to drive through our facility. It breaks it down. Step 1, 2 through 14, I believe it is. 13. So it tells you exactly what you guys are required to do as you're pulling through. Just be aware of that. It's pretty simple. If you need me to send this electronically, I can. That way you can give it off to all your drivers and then you have it, okay? We do have pre-pass and drive-wise. This is a separate entity than CHP. companies pay these two companies to drive by our facilities. If you notice, some tractor trailers are driving by. Unfortunately, PBI cares, you're not allowed to get pre-pass or drive-wise, okay? So things may change in the future, but as of right now, it's not gonna happen. Back here is Lieutenant Rob Kazar. He's the commander here.
Hi, good morning.
Morning. You have anything to ask, Lieutenant?
Sure, first of all, I'd like to welcome all of you. Like Richard said, my name is Rob and I'm the commander here. And the reason that you're here, hopefully no one takes offense to this term, but you're here out of friendship, okay? And transparency. And to hopefully put you and all of your coworkers' mind at ease when you're coming through here in your coaches. This program that we have with you being up here at the scale head and going through the bays, this is not a departmentally required or sanctioned operation. When we started PBI back in August, we were trying to figure out a way to take some of the mystery or the fear out of the coaches and industry with coming through the operation. You know, I've been doing this job, I'm in my 27th year now, and you kind of get ingrained and you kind of have a style of dealing with people and different kind of situations being out on the street. But being here in this facility, I was a little bit naive and wanted to figure out a way to kind of enhance our friendship and the rapport that we have with all of our drivers, with truck drivers and now coach drivers and bus drivers. So it was actually Richard, I believe, who came up with the idea of opening us up and giving tours to industry, whoever wanted to come and kind of take the mystery away about what happens when you come through here, especially, you know, what happens if you go into this big building here, just you go in there and no one ever sees you again or your vehicle. So now that Richard kind of explained what we have here, I just wanted to introduce myself and thank you all for coming here and taking time out of your day. If anyone has any questions about anything to do with this operation, please let me know, ask Sean, who's now running out of way really quickly, or Richard. And I would like to leave you with, if anybody ever comes here in the future and has somewhat of a negative experience or a bad experience with the operation, please call us immediately and ask to speak to a supervisor or ask to speak to me, the commander. And I'll be happy to talk to you and answer any questions and explain, you know, maybe why what happened. But our goal is to, you know, add some friendship to the operation and be friendly and respectful and courteous with everybody that comes into our bays or inside here. Okay? So any questions that maybe Richard, you didn't ask Richard yet or Sean about the operation?
So the main reason, the primary reason for buses stopping by here is looking for signage, looking for defects on the bus, visible defects.
Right. So the first reason is, which we have no control over here at Gilroy, is a law was passed requiring coaches to stop here, northbound at Gilroy, and then the other two facilities that Richard mentioned. We have no control over that. So once you are here, the primary reason for you being here is a commercial vehicle safety. The safety of the drivers, your precious cargo that you carry, the mechanical condition of your vehicle, the safety of who knows, maybe driving through on the freeway, you know, your friends, your neighbors, your families. So the whole goal is for commercial vehicle safety, both for trucks and for coaches. Okay? So, and as Richard was explaining, we select our vehicles based on decals, an expired decal, no decal, or a good decal but with a mechanical violation. You know, a flat tire, a tire with a bulge in it, the coach coming through here at an angle or crooked, or if we get 911 calls of a coach or a bus driving very erratically, excessive speeds, you know, speeding, slowing down, unsafe lane changes, we'll go out and we'll try to find that vehicle and bring it here and investigate that. But it's all about safety. Okay, and the Why Me flyer that Richard handed out, that'll explain a little bit about what he talked about, the decals. And it's primarily for trucks, so we're in the process of trying to put one together that could incorporate bus information as well. But it talks about, you know, axle weights and bridge weights and, you know, that kind of stuff. We have a question here about what happens when a vehicle comes through with an expired decal, is that correct? Okay, so if a vehicle comes through with an expired decal or no decal, it's just a very good question about what happens with that. So what we'll do is we'll give the vehicle a signal, an electronic signal, a traffic light with an arrow and a message to circle to one of our four bays. So once the vehicle circles around the back and into one of our bays, the door will open up and Richard or one of his coworkers will guide the vehicle in, will have it stop, and then we'll greet the driver, and as nicely as we can, we will request the driver's information, you know, license, paperwork, registration, insurance for trucks, manifest, hazardous materials information if applicable. And while we're doing that, we're kind of evaluating the driver for fatigue, extreme nervousness, signs or symptoms of being under the influence, that type of thing. And then we'll begin the walk around. So we'll be physically walking around the entire vehicle, normally starting at the left front, checking tires, wheels, wheel fasteners, tread depth, tires for bulges. We'll start checking the frame, fueling, exhaust systems, lights, windshield wipers, stop lamp lights, headlights, high beams.
Pre-trip.
Exactly, like a pre-trip on steroids.
Pre-trip on steroids, what I call it.
And yeah. Richard came up with that saying, so every time he says, or I say pre-trip on steroids, I got to give him something. Kind of as a royalty. Yeah. So like a pre-trip on steroids. So once we complete the entire walk around, then we go underneath in either one of the inspection pits or on a creeper and check everything underneath. And if the vehicle passes, meaning it's a clean vehicle with no violations, we give it a sticker, a decal. There's no cost, it's free.
Oh, okay.
So the vehicle gets a sticker and it's good for the time that Richard explained. So the best time to get it is the first week of the month. Okay? So again, there's no charge for the decal. You're not required to give us a credit card or cash or anything like that. And we get those decals from our department that come from Sacramento to our division office in San Luis Obispo and then shipped up here.
It's actually a federal sticker. It's Commercial Vehicle Safety Alliance. Yeah. Okay, so one of the questions was asked.
Did I answer your question?
Yeah, you did.
Okay, all right, go ahead, take it away.
One of the questions was asked is where the decal is placed on a bus. So I'm going to hand you guys an out-of-service guide here. It's going to be your own personal out-of-service guide. But if you look at this picture here, it goes on the door at eye level for us. All right?
Okay, so a question that often comes up from the drivers is if I get pulled in here and something is observed on the vehicle, am I going to get a ticket? Am I going to be arrested? Is my vehicle going to be impounded? Am I going to get fired from my company? Is there some law that requires the boss to fire me? So, kind of clear up some of the myths and the misnomers about what happens when a vehicle is circled for an inspection. So, typically for a company like yours, if a mechanical defect is observed, and a citation is issued, it will be written to the company as owner's responsibility, not to the driver. Okay? So if something happens where a mechanical defect is noted, either it's a violation or a violation and out of service, and a citation is written, that's going to go to the company, not to the driver. It's not going to be on the driver's record. The driver's name will be on the citation, but in the signature box, it's going to say owner's responsibility. Okay? So the number one thing that will keep all of the drivers, are you all drivers here?
Yes.
So the number one thing that will keep you out of trouble is do not bypass our facility and make us hunt you down. Okay? So please enter the facility, and if you don't get any signals to circle, just keep on going. But if you do get that signal to circle to one of the bays, please observe those. Okay? Not that anybody here would be involved in anything like this, but if a driver were to come in here under the influence of something, alcohol, prescription drugs, street drugs, that could be a problem for that driver as well. That does not go against the company, that goes against the driver. Okay? Hours of service, if a driver, a truck driver, or a coach driver exceeds their hours of service, interstate or intrastate, that could be an issue for the driver as well. But the number one thing to remember is, as a driver, please enter our facility and follow whatever directions you're given. If you don't stop through here, then we hop in one of our patrol cars and we have to stop you, and it could be a misdemeanor for failing to submit to an inspection. Okay? The black and white signs that direct trucks and now coaches to come in here, those are regulatory signs like speed limit signs. But in addition to that, it's also a misdemeanor for failing to stop and submit to an inspection. So please remember that.
So, for example, if you guys are heading this way and you decide to go over on Monterey, cross over because you know our facility's here, and you're like, you know what, I'm running late, I don't have time for an inspection, so you decide to go on Monterey, head north, and go back on 101. We have officers that are back there, commercial officers that are back there. Okay. You're not required to be, you are not allowed to be back there. The only way you can go back there is if you have a drop off or a pickup. And it has to be the fastest way in and the fastest way out. For example, if you have school kids, there's a school back here. You got to go in, pick up your children, and come out the fastest way. And then come back on 101 through our facility. So if you decide to go around us, whatever direction, that is considered bypassing our facility. Okay? So we don't want that. Like we said, it's a point and a half. All right? If you fail to obey these signs, they can go out and they can write you the same. As I said earlier, an officer actually cited a driver for not stopping at that red light. They took it to court and it stood, okay? So we don't want that. Just be observant of all our signs. Just pay attention. We're gonna stop you. We're gonna direct you. We're gonna give you commands. Just listen to what we're telling you and you guys will be just fine. All right?
And if for some reason you can't understand what we're saying over the loudspeaker, or there's a glare on the sign because of the sun or another vehicle, you know, we're watching you. So just wave us out there. We'll be happy to come out the door and walk up to you and answer your questions and explain what the signs and signals mean.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah. Believe it or not, we only pull in 5% of the commercial vehicles that run through our facility that have pre-pass. So everybody that has pre-pass, it's only 5% pulling rate. It's not very much, is it? But we still get a lot of traffic. See, all those trucks going by, those are all pre-pass vehicles there.
Yeah. How do you know that?
Pre-pass or driveway. So we have a monitor inside that tells us, it gives us a license plate number, gives us the carrier name. So if a vehicle that goes by that doesn't have pre-pass, it'll actually notify us and see non-pre-pass truck. And so if the officers choose, they can go out and pull the truck over and bring it back for inspection, or just cite it out there for bypassing the scales. All right, so as we're going through the center lane here, we have different signs, okay? We have the static lane, which is on the right here. That's where we static out vehicles. This is considered the empty lane, and those are way in motions. We actually do have way in motions in both sides, in the middle lane and the outer lane. This is the overhead sensors here, as you can see. And there, right there, you have a red light. Okay, those are considered traffic lights, so you do need to obey it. So he should stop. And so as you can see, we go ahead and give them the green arrow if we want them to circle around the building. And then at the end there, it says circle the building, the door number 4. We do give you audible commands, depending on, you know, if it's real windy or something, sometimes it's, you really can't hear them, but we try to do our best to make it clear and concise. So as you're pulling around the lanes, we have speed limits back here. We do have people that work on vehicles. We have people walking around, so be careful. We cannot have a smog inspection, so don't worry about that sign. And then there's those signs that basically notify you to go around the facility. So scale inspections, door 1 and door 2. So it tells you what lanes you should be in. Okay. So we have, this is the parking area for all the vehicles that are placed out of service. They have their own maintenance people come and repair the vehicles on site so they can drive them away. And as you can see, there's still more black and white signs. Those are all regulatory signs, okay? So you guys, this is considered the freeway, so you need to obey the signs as well. So we have inspections lanes right here. 1, 2, 3, and 4. So as you can see, the lanes are numbered right there on the bottom. So we're going to door number 4, so you want to stay in that lane as best as possible. So just to be aware, we do have pedestrians walking around the area, so just be mindful of your surroundings. And what we need you to do at this point is, we usually stop the vehicles outside. You want to pay attention. We have no idle inside, so you don't want to keep your vehicle running if you're waiting out here for an extended period of time. And then, again, you want to wait for the door to completely open. We do have traffic lights inside. You'll be able to see them. We have a red light when the door is not open completely, and then once the door is open completely, the green light will flash, and then we'll go ahead and guide you in, okay? Thank you.
So the first thing we do when you pull in, we'll check your headlights. So we'll check your lights real quick. Just since that's one of the things you'll do in the driver's seat. So go and turn the key to the on position. And then I'll have you turn the headlights on just like you're driving down the road.
Alright. Okay. I think we might need to start it.
And then what I'm going to have you do is I'm going to do each turn signal. So I'll point to the direction of the turn signal I want. And then when I raise my hands like this, I want your high beams.
Okay.
And when I put my hand out like that, apply the brakes.
Okay.
Okay?
Can I even start the bus because I think the battery light is coming on. So.
Yeah, you can start the bus. Okay. And then what I'll do is I'll go to the back of the bus. And then I'm going to have you do the reverse lights. Okay. So when I do this, I want you to put the reverse lights on, okay? You don't have a sticker on your window, okay? So we're just gonna do a quick inspection of your bus. All right, and then I'll ask you for your driver's license. You don't have to get it right now, but you have your driver's license. If you keep a log, I'm gonna ask you for your log, okay? That way I can see if you're not over hours, make sure you're maintaining everything that you're supposed to, okay? I'm gonna come into the door over there. So once I get all the paperwork, so we'll include your driver's license, whether you... Oh yeah, we gotta put it for the report. We'll check to make sure, is that your current address?
Yes, sir.
Okay. There's a couple of numbers that we have to pull, so we'll look for your VIN plate, because we have to get the number of passengers for the bus, and we have to get the total weight for the bus, but that's for our documentation purposes. Okay. Right now, we're not handling paperwork. We just run the bus, but once COVID goes away, we'll ask you for registration for the bus and all that. Okay, yes, if you're carrying any hazardous materials, say like you put it into any of the compartments and carry a load too, we'll ask for those papers as well, okay? Once we get the documentation, we put it on the report, and then we're gonna come back and we're gonna contact you. So when I come back and contact you and start the interior of the inspection, what we're gonna do is we're gonna check your seatbelt. We'll start with that. So go ahead and click your seatbelt on. Okay, go get a nice little tug for me. Make sure it works. Okay, now you can take it off if you want. All right, now we're going to check the movement of your seat. Make sure it moves forward and back. And then we want to make sure if it goes up and down, that it can go up and down. Okay. Next, we'll check the movement of the steering wheel, where you can lift it up, adjust it to your needs. Okay? Perfect. Since we got the bus on, we'll do the defrosters. Okay. All right. Next thing we'll do is we'll do the windshield wipers.
Let me jump this over.
Okay. And then also the windshield wiper fluid. Oh, one worse. No worse. Okay, that's good. All right, now we're gonna look at your mirrors. We just wanna make sure that you can adjust your mirrors if need be. Okay, so it can be automatic or manual.
Manual.
Okay. That's good. The other thing is to make sure that you have a mirror for the interior of the bus so that you can see your passengers, making sure if they're not doing anything they're not supposed to. Okay. We'll also check your visors. Make sure that they go up and down so they don't get stuck so that you can't see. Okay. And then you can raise it back up. And the same thing with your side visor. Okay. And then the one thing we're going to look as well is around your space. So make sure you don't have anything around your feet. You don't have water bottles. Everything's put away so that you can't roll. Nothing can interfere with the gas pedal or the brake pedal or anything like that.
Okay.
Okay.
So should I step out of here?
Oh, no, I can see. And when you step away, when I have you do the emergency exit, I'll also take another look because I want to make sure this is clear. I'm going to make sure the aisles are clear. So the last thing up here I'm going to have you do is we're going to check the emergency release on the door. So you'll close the door and we'll pretend like it's an emergency and then I'll have you release it and do the manual open. Okay. So you're gonna have to open every single emergency exit to make sure that it works, okay? So we'll start on one side of the bus, and then we'll work our way to the other side, okay? Here as just goes upstairs. And then we'll do the roof hatch. Just put it to the vent position.
Okay.
Yeah, just the vent. All we're making sure is, first of all, that this will latch shut, and that it's gonna open in case of emergency. So, we don't care if it stays open for the ventilation. We just wanna make sure that if something happens with the bus and it goes on its side, that passengers can get out this exit.
Supposed to be, there's not supposed to be a lock on it.
Okay.
Somehow.
So this is the vent position right here?
Yep.
Okay. And then it's just gonna open up.
Yeah.
Got it? Okay. Yeah, we'll go back down. Check to make sure all your seats are permanently mounted. Yeah, secure, they're not gonna fall out. We're gonna check all the seat belts, make sure all the seat belts latch. So you want the latch plates to go into the buckles and to stay hooked. So we'll check all those. And then like I said, we're gonna check the aisles, make sure that we don't have anything in the aisles, because if we get into an emergency, we wanna make sure that people aren't gonna be tripping over themselves trying to get out. And make sure that if you have overhead storage compartments that nothing's gonna fall out or anything like that. So basically the same thing you guys do when you're out there, we just want to make sure that it's properly secure. So, you can check the seatbelts, all we do. Cross. So once we finish the inside, we're gonna go to the outside. We're gonna have you open up all the compartments for the bus.
Okay.
Okay. Any compartment that we can get open, we'll get open so we can take a look at the bus.
Okay.
Okay.
So we're gonna ask the bus to pull in. Make sure the door is completely open. Make sure you have a green light. Okay. We're gonna guide you in. We want you to put your front wheel as close as you can on that white line, and we'll direct you as straight as possible. We're gonna stop you up to this point. Once we get you stopped, we're gonna check your turn signals. We're gonna check the left one, the right one. We're gonna check your high beams, your low beams. We're gonna check your brake lights, and then we're gonna check your backup lights. Then we're gonna observe your bus while all the lights are on and make sure all your required lighting is working, okay? Once we're done with gathering all the information, once we're done with entering everything into our inspection report, we're gonna start on this side, okay? So, like I said earlier, it's a three-man team. We have an officer and our service inspecting the interior. We have somebody doing the exterior, and then we have somebody going underneath. So when we're out here, we're gonna have you open up every luggage compartment that you have. We're gonna have you open up the fuel cap compartment. We're gonna have you open up the spare tire compartment.
We're gonna have you open up the handshake compartment. We want to see electrical compartment, battery, where the batteries are stored. We're gonna have you open up that compartment as well. All right, so we're gonna systematically work our way around the bus, okay? So we're gonna chalk it, we're gonna start at the front here. We're gonna be grabbing, we're gonna put everything. We use hands, we don't use any tools. We're not allowed to have any tools on us, okay? Other than our pen and our marker. I'm gonna grab your mirror, make sure that's secure, make sure it's there, okay? I'm gonna look at, observe your windshield. Officer Nichols checked your windshield wipers. He's gonna turn those off, turn those on. He's gonna check your fluid and so forth. He's gonna check your visors. So I'm looking at your windshield to make sure there's no cracks in front of the driver. If you have a crack over there on that side, yeah, it's an issue. You guys need to repair it. Our concern is that this crack is right in front of the driver and it's obstructing your view. That's our concern. That's when we start putting that stuff on the reports, okay? So I'm gonna work my way around. I'm gonna continue to look at your bus. And then I'm gonna start at your steer axle here, okay? I'm gonna thump your tire to make sure it's inflated. I'm gonna check your tire rating to make sure that whatever it is, it's not 50% less than the rating. Anything 50% less of the rating, so if it's 110, it's 50% less than that, we consider it flat, okay? I'm gonna observe your tread here. I'm gonna make sure the tread is the proper depth on a steer axle. On a steer axle, it's completely different than in the back, okay? On a steer axle, it's 4/32. I'm gonna look at your wheels. Make sure they're not cracked anywhere on the wheel. I'm gonna check your fasteners to make sure your fasteners are secure. I'm gonna look at your sidewall to make sure there's no cuts or no cord separation. I'm gonna make sure there's no bulges on the sidewall, okay? If there's a bulge sticking out, a big knot, and sticking out more than 3/8 of an inch, we have an issue, all right? I'm gonna make sure that your front tire, or any tire for that matter, is rated for highway use. Believe it or not, we see trucks on here, those tires aren't for highway use. They're not supposed to be on the road.
How do you know that?
It stipulates on the side of the tire.
Okay.
For highway use or not highway use, okay? Last week we had a bus that had a crack, a 3-inch crack on the front rim. 3 inches. On our out of service guys, it gives us guidelines. It can be cracked in excess of 3 inches. That's an out of service. It can be cracked from hole to hole. Hole to hole could be like a manhole or handhole here. It could be from a fastener hole to here. If there's any cracks that extend through this, it's an out of service, all right? Or there could be a number of cracks, maybe 4 or 5 cracks on the wheel. That could place the vehicle out of service. It all depends. Aluminum wheels tend to crack a lot more than steel wheels. What I have seen on a steel wheel is all the fasteners for the wheel were elongated. They were actually looped like this. And so the wheel was kind of sliding.
Yeah.
It was doing this, all right? So we're checking that stuff. We're checking the suspension portion of your bus inside, what we can see, all your components, all your frames, all your airbags. We're looking in and making sure nothing's broken. Everything's supposed to be there. Again, I'm checking your tread. I'm looking for nails, any foreign objects. I'm listening to make sure it's not leaking air. Okay, I'm looking at the valve to make sure it's not leaking air from there as well. All right, so on the steer axle, tread depth is what? 4/32.
Yes.
Remember that, okay? We're looking for tears, bulges, so forth. All right, and that's about it. That's all we're looking at. Your guys' pre-trip?
Yeah.
On steroids, just a little bit difference here and there, okay? We're gonna work our way back. We're just checking compartments to make sure nothing's leaking, nothing's broken, nothing's faulty, okay? Looking inside here, we're looking at subframe. That's all your subframe in there. Yes, subframe here, subframe here. Basically, all we're making sure is that that's not cracked, it's not damaged in any fashion, okay? Usually these buses don't crack in the subframes, but we're just looking. Okay, we're checking the wires, if you have any wires dangling around. We're just making sure there's no bare wire, there's nothing that can catch fire. Once we get back to axle 2, anybody know what the tread depth on axle 2 is?
2/32. 2/32,
awesome. So 2/32, if that tread depth is below 2/32, we have an issue. All right, or if you have something foreign objects leaking and so forth. The same thing I'm doing on the axle 2 is I'm gonna do on the front. I'm gonna check the sidewall, I'm gonna check for highway use, I'm gonna check all your fasteners, I'm gonna check your hubs to make sure they're not blowing out or leaking. If you have two tires, okay, I'm gonna thump them, make sure that they're not flat. I'm gonna look inside. I'm gonna make sure the tires aren't making contact with the bus.
Now, question. Because you got the wood truck, when we take the air brake off?
Air brakes are off, yeah.
Oh, it is off?
I don't know if they release it or not, but we usually have them not release, not set it when they pull in. If the tires are making contact with each other, right, that's what we're looking for that as well. Stuff like that. Flat tires, nails and tread, if it's below tread depth, that's what we're looking for. Here's the thing. So on a steer axle, and y'all have a single tire, if we have a violation less than 430, less than 230 seconds on a steer axle, and it's in three locations, three major tread grooves, it automatically places this bus out of service. All right. If you have a set of tires back here and they're less than 130 seconds and it's in three locations across three major tread grooves, but you have two tires, it's not an out of service. It has to be on both tires. All right. That's a single steer axle. It's its own category. Get back here. If you have a set of duals and you have a violation on only one of the tires, both tires need to meet it to be an out of service. Okay. If you have a flat tire on the other hand, though, it's an out of service. It doesn't matter if you have two or one. Okay. If it's leaking air, if it's flat, it's leaking. It's out of service. So we get back here. Here's the tag. All right. Does this turn as well? Do you know?
No. No.
Just raise it up.
Just raise it up and straight. Okay. So we're checking the same thing. We're checking here. We're checking on this side. Doesn't matter. All right. We got tread depth, sidewall, fasteners, rims. We're looking inside, looking at your rotors and your disc components to make sure they're not cracked, make sure there's no contaminants. We're looking inside the frame here as well to make sure your airbags are inflated. All your support beams are good. And that's about the stuff. That's really all we're checking for. It's the same thing you guys do on the pre-trip.
Exactly.
And that's what we're doing, okay? So again, all your panels, making sure there's none of this leaking. Working our way back. We're just looking inside, making sure nothing's sagging, broken, or missing, leaking, contaminants, no bare wires, no evidence of maybe possibly something catching on fire, okay? Once I get back here, we are checking your belts. We're making sure they're not fraying, we're making sure they're not damaged, we're making sure you have them. We're checking all your fasteners, okay? Making sure nothing's loose. And we're making sure these belts have all their teeth on them, all right? The common thing for us is just the belt starting to fray or damage. That's a common violation for us. We're looking at all your fasteners here, all the mounts, making sure they're secure. We're making sure there's no excessive oils or fluids leaking, radiator fluid leaking from this point, going down to the ground. And that's about the extent of this, okay? That's all we're doing. We just wanna make sure everything's tight, everything's where it's supposed to be, and we're good, okay? If you have an exhaust system, depending on diesel or gas, we need to make sure the port is on the right location, but that could vary depending on the type of vehicle we're dealing with, okay? All right, go ahead and walk around, please. So again, we finished the compartments, we're working our way back. In here, we're just checking subframe. Batteries, we need to make sure that we observe the batteries. We wanna make sure there's no corrosion, there's no bare wire, something can catch fire, okay? So if you have your drivers come out, they need to be able to take these panels off. We need to be able to see them, all right? One of the carriers actually contacted Prevost and they're actually looking into putting something clear here. So we can just look in so they don't have to take them off. I'm not saying you guys have to do that. It's just your drivers need to be aware that we're gonna wanna take a look at these batteries so we can observe if there's anything faulty going on with them, okay? Corrosion is the big thing, and maybe a bare wire. All right, we don't want that coming into contact with the bus. All right, catching fire, or you're killing it for that matter. So here's the thing, the same thing we did on the other side, we're gonna do on this side. Tires, tread depth, wheels, fasteners, brake parts, suspension parts, anything we can see from above, we're looking at, observing, making sure you have your fuel caps, tire depth, wheels, fasteners. And then we're gonna go back to axle one and do the same process we did on the other side, okay? That's your pre-trip, pretty much. We're just doing it a little bit more extensively, maybe, depending on who's inspecting the bus, all right? Any questions whatsoever? No? You have the out of service guide.
I do.
That breaks down all the violations I was talking about. How many fasteners need to be loose? How many fasteners need to be missing? The cracks on the wheels, how they 3 inches or more.
We teach them zero.
Everything, right.
We teach them nothing.
We're actually putting together an out-of-service class, so we can have drivers or companies come down and we're going to teach our out-of-service guide. So when that's available, I can contact you guys. If you guys are interested in something like that, you can come down. We actually have a carrier that's bringing their equipment down, and we're going to actually do a Zoom class. So we're going to Zoom and talk to all their drivers as well. So it's up to you guys how you want to make arrangements, but we're here to assist you. If you want to go over the out-of-service guide, you want to go over vehicle code sections, if you want to go over our procedures and policies, we can do that. Just let us know what you want, and we can make arrangements and make it happen. Prior to COVID-19, we're bringing huge classes down, filling up our training room with drivers and doing this all in one large group. But right now we're kind of restricted because of everything that's going on. Hopefully soon this is going to go away and we can get back to some normal working conditions and bring all you guys in large groups in one time and just do this all at once, okay? So we have commercial education classes. We're getting an app so you can just sign up for it. And we'll have available dates and times, and then we can just schedule that way, and you don't have to worry about calling me or calling Officer Scotto or calling Officer Nichols. Okay? All right, so any questions? We're good?
No.
We're working up to the steer axle. We're basically checking the same thing, okay? Making sure its tires inflated, checking tread depth, wheels, fasteners, looking at suspension components inside, looking at brake components inside here as well, and that's it. All right, lighting, tires, wheels. Pre-trip. Pretty simple, huh? Nothing that you guys don't already do. Right?
We actually do a more thorough pre-trip.
You guys do?
We do.
Yeah.
We do.
Yeah, and so that's the thing, though. It's better for you guys to do it that way. It's better for you to do your pre-trip prior to leaving, finding the stuff wrong, because we don't want it to come in here and then let's find it, because obviously that's going to start affecting inspection reports and scores and so forth, okay? I let one of the carriers know, said, hey, maybe you should do your pre-trip and open up the windows prior to leaving the yard.
Yeah.
Because we've been finding a lot of emergency exits faulty, not open and closing as designed consistently. And I was like, check the bus before you leave. That way it doesn't come through here and we're not inspecting it. Do it there, not here. Okay, because if it's here, we got to jot it down on a report. So make sure you're doing it there. If something's wrong, have your mechanics finish theirs, change buses out. Just make sure the bus is safe prior to leaving your yard. That's all we're asking. All right?
I'll see you. Thanks, Bill.
See you later. Okay. All right. So we're starting in the front, okay? We all systematically start on one side. We like to start on the roadside, driver's side, whatever you want to call it, left side. So we're checking all your subframe down below, okay? We're making sure nothing's cracked, broken, sagging, possibly making contact with the roadway. While we're down here, we're gonna check all your steering components, okay? We're gonna check your steering gearbox, your pitman arm, your sector shaft, your tie rods, your drag links, so forth, okay? We're looking at all the components in relation to steering, steering shaft. When we get further back, we're gonna check all your suspension components. We're gonna check your A-arms. We're gonna check your sway bars if need be. We're gonna check brake components, calipers, rotors, okay? We're gonna make sure that they're operational. We're gonna make sure they're not cracked, broken, or missing. We're gonna check the pads and make sure you have the proper depth. So what I like to do, and what Officer Nichols does, is he starts on the side and he kind of works his way back. Once he's done with this particular side, he's gonna jump over, finish the other side, and work his way the other way. Again, steering components, right? Here's your steering shaft here. I'm putting my hands on this and manipulating this, so if it's moving, we have issues, right? Fasteners here. We have fasteners here, okay? Steering gearbox, we're looking at that. We're looking at cross members under here to make sure they're not cracked or broken, okay? Checking out air tubings to make sure there's no damage to air tubing. It's not crimped, it's not chafing, it's not worn to the second color. We're making sure that they're not leaking as well. Sometimes they're weathered, they crack, and they leak, okay? We're looking at the inside of your tire. We're checking for bulges, tears, the same as we would on the outside. We're looking underneath at your tread. Maybe we missed something on top. So we're looking underneath here and observing your tread on the tire, okay? We're looking at all brake components, calipers, rotors, calipers, fasteners, suspension components, axle, A-arms, whatever the case might be, okay? We're making sure they're tight and secure. Okay, we're looking at spindles. Air hoses up on top that feed the brake chambers. We're making sure there's no bulges, they're not worn into or through the cords. We're looking at your tie rods up there. Okay, steering components here. Making sure nothing moves my hand. Checking the shock to make sure that's not loose as well. It's a maintenance issue. All your A-arm components, right? Here. Once we're done with this side, we're gonna do the same thing on this side. Check your tires, steering components, okay, spindles, rotors, calipers, tread area, brake chambers, make sure they're mounted, okay? We're gonna put our hands on stuff. We're gonna check your hoses, okay? We're gonna look at the upper A-arms, bag mounts, air hoses that go up there, whatever the case might be, all right? We're just making sure that it's not damaged, possibly leaking. Once we're done with the front suspension, we're gonna check your undercarriage. We're gonna go back and forth, check your subframe, make sure it's not cracked, okay? We just wanna make sure everything's mounted, not loose, not in danger of falling off. Scanning back and forth, looking at structural components, stress areas to make sure they're not cracked, okay? On both sides, just scanning back and forth, okay? All right, cracks there, if we're cracked, we're looking. Once we get back to axle two, we're doing the same thing. Checking your tread, checking torque arm, checking suspension beams, okay? Checking disc brakes, checking sway bars, checking mounts. Making sure these bushings aren't walking out and coming out, making sure these bushings are there. Making sure these bushings aren't, you know, this bushing's not to the point where it's shifting back and forth. Checking these fasteners. If there's any looseness in this general area, you'll see maybe some evidence of some shiny marks or some rust, and you'll see evidence of it possibly moving, okay? That's what we're looking for. That's an indicator of something being loose. So we finished the whole left side here, checking the inside tire, checking brake lines, making sure they're not cracked, making sure they're not broken if they have them, making sure the rotors and calipers are good, making sure there's no friction metal to metal, making sure there's no contaminants on the surface of that rotor. There is, it could be one brake or it could be a faulty hub, and it could place the vehicle out of service. So again, once we finish this portion, systematically jumping over, checking airbags, suspension beams, torque arm components, okay? Tires, sidewall, brake systems, sway bar, air hoses, okay? These two air hoses were rubbing together like this, chafing, and it caused damage to this air hose, and it's worn through the cores. Okay, we could have a out of service violation depending on how bad it is. But as long as they're like this, far away, and they're good, we have no issues, okay? And we're checking driveline. All right, so the driveline, we got opposing joints, we have a universal joint here, we have a yoke here, we have your driveline. I had a carrier that had, it was a bus, that had all four of these mounting bolts on this driveline were loose. Automatically out of service, okay? Right here, all four of these bolts. If you have movement in between these opposing joints and that universal joint, and I have to be able to move it by hand, and it exceeds an eighth of an inch vertical, that joint is no longer good. That is an out of service, meets the out of service criteria, and we have some issues, okay? With buses, type ones, they're required to have safety loops, okay? Depending on how long the driveline is, it could depend on how many safety loops you have. So we're looking to make sure they're there. I'm moving stuff to make sure there's no movement in the yokes. and checking the drive line and the mounting of the safety loop. This right here is not structural. But, for example, if this was in danger of falling off and going through somebody's windshield, it could be an out of service, right? Imminent hazard. That's what I'm talking about. So this right here is not structural, has nothing to do with anything else other than protect maybe some components. But if it's gonna fall off and hit somebody, then at that point, we're gonna say, you know what, your bus can't leave until you either mount that or take it off. Something like that, okay? We're checking again your drive line, safety loops, other structural items, manipulating airbags, checking components. Okay, A-arms here, fasteners here, fasteners here, fasteners here, okay? This is a tag, checking all your brake components here, everything. So I'm gonna do, I kind of bounced around a little bit, but I'm gonna do it the same way. What I would do is I would start in the front and work my way all the way back, jump over, work my way all the way forward, and then I would do the center inspection, then I would move back, okay? While we're under here, we're checking frames, okay? We're checking mounts for the engine. We're making sure there's not excessive fluid, oil, contaminants on the ground, all right? Checking all these cross beams here. Checking to make sure there's no radiator fluid leaking over here. Checking your exhaust system to make sure it's in the right location. Depending on its diesel or gas, it could be a difference there, okay? On the location of the exhaust. Once we get to this point, we're gonna come out. We're gonna have Officer Nichols show the driver the orange flag. And at that point, they should step on the brake. Okay, so they're holding the brake down. As they're holding the brake down, we don't have brake adjustment on disc brakes, right? But we are listening for air loss. So on occasion, if the driver is not giving me a full brake application, this valve could possibly leak. Sometimes there's debris that gets caught up in here and it could leak like that. But if it stops to leak like it is now, then we're not concerned. If it continuously is blowing air out, then we have issues, okay? So again, there's no brake adjuster. We're checking for air loss. We're checking for air loss, no brake adjustment. Okay, once we get to this point, we're gonna have him release his brake. Are you ready, Nicole? You guys cover your ears, okay? Good, release. All right, rock your steering side to side, hard as you can. All right, so we're rocking, look. Steering components, we're checking steering shaft, yokes there, we're checking pivot arm, gearbox, drag link ball joint. We're working our way back. Go ahead and work your way back. Work your way back. All right, we're checking ball joints here. There's vertical movement in that ball joint in excess of an eighth inch, and we can move it by hand and we have some issues. While we're here, we're checking some suspension components. As he's rocking, if the suspension's loose, it'll move side to side, okay? Once we get here, we have more steering components up there, upper arm, here, bouncing back over here. We have another idler arm bouncing back over here, okay? That's good. If I can grab this tie rod and move it, and we have vertical movement in excess of an eighth inch with hand pressure, that means the out of service. It's a violation and right automatically an out of service. The key is I gotta be able to move it by hand, all right? If it's rocking the steering wheel and this is popping a little bit and I grab it and I can't move it, I can't write it up. What I can do is I can put it in the notes and let the mechanic know, hey, pay attention to that tie rod, it's getting some movement. Maybe the next time it's inspected, it might be an out of service, okay? All right, once he's done that, that pretty much completes the undercarriage of the bus.